morning and welcome to Chicago. It is great to be with you this morning. You know, I got up early this morning. I felt pretty good and wanted to get going. So I got here a little early and I was in the back of the hall and I was sitting there and I was going through my speech and Rich Trumka walked in and I've known Rich forever and he looked real down and I said, "What's the matter?" And he said, "My boy screwed up. They didn't send me my speech that I'm supposed to be giving here at the SMART conference." And he says, "I got to go on in just 10 minutes. I said, "Rich, you're my friend. Take my speech." Didn't he do a hell of a job? Honest to goodness. What a quick study. I mean, I just handed it to him. Beautiful, beautiful job Rich did, you know. Now I don't have much to tell you, but let me just mention a couple things. Joe gave a nice introduction, talked about, you know, some of the things that I've been able to do in my public service, being a senator from this great state representing this magnificent city of Chicago. And, you know, I said to my wife, Loretta, she's been by my side through this entire political career. I said, "Did you ever think back in the day when we got started running first time, and I lost, incidentally, running the first time for office, that I would end up being in the United States Senate representing Illinois, in the leadership in the United States Senate? In your wildest dreams, did you think that I'd end up in this spot?" And she said, "Dick, in all honesty, you're not in my wildest dreams." So I understand that, you know? After a lot of years of marriage, she's entitled to change the channel once in a while. I get it, you know? But I'm honored to be with you, and I want to tell you very briefly a few things that I think are important for you to know. First, I am proud to be the son of a union family. My mother, my father, my two brothers, and I were all members of labor unions in East St. Louis, Illinois. My grandfather was a bus driver in a union. Mom and Dad, my two brothers and I, all worked for the New York Central Railroad. My dad was a member of the railway clerks, as was my mom. I belonged to unions all through my life, and I stand here today because of it. I honestly believe that. And I'm not just saying it because I'm looking out at an audience full of people who believe in unionism too. I'm living proof of it. Mom and Dad had eighth grade educations. Mom was an immigrant to this country. My dad had a hard work ethic. He wasn't a great scholar, but man, he knew how to do his job and do it well. And the union protected him and gave him a living wage in his time, as it did for my mom. And they got to send their three boys off to college. And I stand here today because of it. That's my story. That's my family's story. That's America's story. And what happened in the 1940s and 50s and 60s in America, when the labor union movement was the strongest it's ever been in our history, our economy was the strongest it has ever been in our history too. It is no coincidence. Because there were people like you, your fathers, your grandfathers, generations before you, who were willing to get up and fight to make sure that there was a good contract, a good wage, good benefits, and a safe working place, America prospered. And you know what the members of your unions did? They turned around and they bought a car, didn't they? And they bought a home, didn't they? And then another car, and then a washer and a dryer, and they put some money in the bank because they wanted to send those kids to college. And we led the world. We led the world when the labor movement was leading America. That's the reality. But it's not ancient history. It is our goal and our ideal still today. And we can do it. But God knows we've got to fight on our hands. In this state of Illinois, how many folks are here from Illinois? Quite a few. I want to tell you, we got a battle on our hands that's been fought in many other states like Michigan and Indiana, Missouri, Wisconsin. We got a governor who wants to do away with unions. He's been darn clear about it. He wants to make this a right-to-work state. And you know what that means? It means lowering the wages of working people. It's the same thing you hear from Trump, we hear from our Republican governor. I had a chance to have dinner with him one night. He invited me and my wife in to one of his homes. It's a beautiful place. And we had a nice dinner. And I said to him, "Listen, I believe in unions. I come from unions. if you as governor have a problem with unions, call me. I'll go to the table with you. I'll sit down with you. If they're wrong, I'll say it publicly. If you're wrong, I'll say it publicly too. But I found you can work with them if you sit down and reason and talk about common values and common goals. And he said, you don't get it. This is not about working with them. This is about getting rid of them. And he meant it, and he's shown it. And that kind of mentality is still out there on the Republican side, sadly. It isn't just in the state capitals, and there's plenty of it, north of us, Scott Walker and all the rest of that gang, but it's also in the halls of Congress. And that's where I've been working for a long time, 20 years now in the United States Senate. And what I see in that Senate today is something that makes me sad and angry. We should be increasing the minimum wage across America to a living wage for every person willing to get up and put in a good day's work. We should make sure that there's paid family medical leave for those who get sick and need to come off the job for a period of time. We should make sure as well that we have trade agreements that respect the working people in this country, that make sure our highest priority is keeping good paying jobs right here. You know, you can't open a newspaper without reading about another major corporation, American corporation, that wants to pick up and move its headquarters overseas. You've read it, haven't you? Every time you turn around. And you say to yourself, didn't you benefit from being in America? Didn't you benefit from the laws, the traditions, and the values of this country that built your business, made you profitable, and paid your CEO? And now you want to pick up and stop paying taxes in this country? That is absolutely unacceptable. And frankly, we need to do something about it. What we can do about it is pretty basic. We need to have a law which is called the Patriot Corporations Act. We give tax breaks to corporations that want to move their businesses overseas. Why in the hell aren't we giving tax breaks to companies that keep their jobs here in America and in Canada? Why aren't we saying to them, if you pay a decent wage to your workers, we'll give you tax breaks. You're going to give them good health care benefit package, you're going to get a tax break to do it. Why aren't we giving that incentive for those who hire America's veterans, for example? Give them a break too. Let's incentivize creating good paying jobs in America. Now I listened to Rich, and that was his speech, incidentally. I listened to Rich Trumka talk to you about this presidential race. I want to tell you, I work in the Senate where I get up in the morning and I go into the Senate gym for no apparent reason, and I run into a bunch of Republican senators, and they're looking at their shoes. They're embarrassed. They're embarrassed for their party, the party of Abraham Lincoln, Teddy Roosevelt, Dwight David Eisenhower. Now is the party of Donald J. Trump. And a lot of these folks are trying to figure out what in the hell happened that led to this. Well, I'll tell you what happened. About 10 million people voting in the Republican primary decided that they liked him more than 14 or 15 other candidates who were in the race. How did they reach the point that Trump looked so good? I'll explain it to you. It's pretty simple. If you watch Fox TV 24/7, 365, if you go to sleep to the lullabies of Rush Limbaugh, if you are coached by Ann Coulter, then you're going to start thinking this is the new normal. Everybody's just as crazy as I am. And that's how this fellow won this primary. But if you listen to what he has to say about America, it is embarrassing. It is an embarrassment to this country that this man would stand up and criticize my colleague John McCain, who was a prisoner of war in Vietnam for over 5 years, that he would call our military a disaster, that he would take on a Gold Star family. Let me tell you, I know he didn't like that speech given by the Khan family at our convention in Philadelphia, but when it comes to a Gold Star family, there's a basic rule in politics, whatever party you belong to, suck it up, my friend, and shut up. This family has a right to speak out even if you hate what they have to say. And he didn't learn that. And he didn't learn the basics along the way when it came to dealing with people. And we've got to make sure we do something about it. Now, let me say something Rich didn't say. I go by union work sites here in Chicago, and I see workers with cars with Trump stickers on them. You know what I'm talking about. In your locals, there are going to be people who are for Donald Trump. They've been for Republicans in the past. They'll be for him again in the future. I don't know that you're going to change them. For some of them, they're all wound up over a guns issue or whatever it happens to be. You can't touch them, and you understand that. But there are others that need to hear the story and the facts, and you're the only ones who can deliver it to them and tell them what's really at stake in this election. And I'll be real specific. I'm going to close here by just giving you an assignment. I work in the United States Senate. Right now, the score in the United States Senate is 54-46. 54 Republicans and 46 Democrats. We consistently lose because we have 46 and they have over 50. We consistently see their priorities come to the floor and our priorities ignored. Mitch McConnell of Kentucky controls the Senate and controls its agenda. But what I'm here to tell you is we've got a chance to change it. And since you come from all over the United States, and welcome to our friends from Canada, but since you come from all over the United States, let me tell you how we change it. We keep Michael Bennett in as a senator from Colorado. He's a terrific senator, deserves to be reelected. We've got a key contest. It's neck and neck. It's going to the wire to keep Harry Reid's seat in the United States Senate from Nevada with Catherine Cortez Masto, great candidate, attorney general of that state. You've heard about Tammy Duckworth. You know her story. She is the person that I'm pushing for Senate here in Illinois. She is number one on the list to make sure we move toward this majority. Her story is an amazing, heroic story of a veteran, disabled veteran who continues to serve this country. Just north of us, Russ Feingold, one of the best, running to be elected in Wisconsin, where we and labor have taken a beating. We know that, but we're going to come back strong. We also have Evan Bayh. Praise the Lord. Evan Bayh decides to run again in Indiana. And Evan can win, is going to win. That's a key vote in state for us. Ted Strickland in Ohio. Ohio's a battleground state for Hillary Clinton and for Donald Trump, and we're going to pour the resources in. Former governor, former congressman Ted Strickland could be the next senator there. Jason Kander from Missouri. Missouri's a tough state. I grew up in East St. Louis. I know. Jason Kander is a solid candidate. Katie McGinty in the state of Pennsylvania. Katie can win that state. Every presidential year, there's an uptick in Democratic votes in Pennsylvania. Katie McGinty can win. Maggie Hassan, governor of New Hampshire. She's a fighter, and she came in this race, and she can win this as well. Deborah Ross in North Carolina, 2 points behind in the polls now. In a state that we lost 2 years ago, we can win this time as President Obama did when he first ran. Patrick Murphy in Florida, an extraordinarily good candidate. And Ann Kirkpatrick from Arizona. Ann Kirkpatrick is a congresswoman. I've come to know her and respect her very much. She can win that race. I know she's running against a well-known incumbent named John McCain. But right now in the polls, she's within 1 or 2 points of winning that seat and giving us the opportunity. And what difference does it make? You think, oh, some new political faces. What the hell difference does it make to me or to my members or to my family? Well, it makes a big difference. Working with Hillary Clinton as president, we can start doing things in this country long overdue. I talked about raising the minimum wage. Organized labor is always behind that. I think that Rich Trumka made it clear that the investment in infrastructure means new buses and new trains and new rail opportunities and new expansion of our infrastructure, building what we need for a strong America to come. We can also talk about dealing with the issues that make a big difference in family lives. We are the party that has offered a way to reduce student debt so our kids don't end up so burdened with debt they don't have a fighting chance in this world today. These are the things we can do. But to do them, we need these folks, and we need you. I stand here today and close by saying thank you. I wouldn't be here without organized labor, not just in my home, but in my political life. You and men and women before you stood behind me when nobody else did and gave me my chance in public service. I thank you for that. And I want to ask you just one parting favor. Give these candidates this year and Hillary Clinton a chance to turn this country around. Thanks, everybody. Welcome to Chicago. Have a great stay.